just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing even as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else?
Yeah, absolutely, because I can't
prove either got to be true or not.
I can't, no.
Good evening, citizens of Netlandia. Welcome to ORLY Radio, show 110B for Friday. Well, I guess now it'd be Wednesday, but Friday, May 20th, 2016, where we dismantle the current events for your edutainment through mostly rational conversations that make you go, oh, really? I'm your host, Andy Cowen, and I've got my usual suspects. I've got Fred Sims, and I've got Daniel Atherton, along with the chat room. Welcome, gentlemen.
We made it back.
We are back. Salutations. Okay, so hopefully you guys out there in Internetlandia have saw our first segment, and that was with two fantastic artists, comic book artists, for the first Adventures on Earth with Adam and Steve. Just a fantastic bunch of people, and they left me art. They actually captured the owl. Look, oh, he's so cute. Love it. So we love them. Thank you very much. And you should go back and listen to show A, 110A, and you'll get the long interview. We did go a little long on that one, but it was well worth it. Well worth it.
A lot of good backstory into the comic, a lot of insight into what they do, where it comes from, you know, what they did. So not only go back and look at 110A, listen to, you know, what they had to say about their art, their project, you know, their passion, but then go and find it. I know that it's at Famous Faces and Funnies. You know, I have personally talked about Free Comic Book May the last couple of weeks. I'll probably talk about it again this week because I'm going to keep it going. Let's get some people down there. Find their comic. It is a $7 comic right now, but it's 46 pages, I believe it is, which is a little bit more than double the size of a normal comic. And normal comics, you know, right now are going for $2.99 to $3.99. For one. So if you double the size of one or you buy two, you're spending about $7.
Yeah, and it's more like an anthology of all of the comics, the strips that they've done for
right.
For
you know, they pulled the best, their favorites, you know, the ones that really present the idea. Go out and find it. Like I said, I know Famous Faces and Funnies has it, and through Todd's Facebook, I believe they will also be getting into Vieira Comics, you know, for those of you in the area that maybe aren't as far south as that. And want something a little closer to where you live, you know, go and find it. It'll be around.
You Brevard County residents.
Local
in
people.
Florida, yeah.
Other people may have to seek it out.
And you can go and find it on the webpage, highburn.com. That's the hosting publisher. So highburn.com/adamsteve1.asp. And then you can just browse through and just get all your giggles right there. Great people, great. It's so much fun. So much fun to have them in studio. So, anywho, let's get into SCOTUS stuff. I was going to say this week in SCOTUS, but you know what? That's too long. So now we're just going to call it SCOTUS stuff because it also might be regional courts, things that happen basically on the high benches. That's what we're going to address in this segment here.
Yeah, because eventually the SCOTUS season ends for a short period, and you know
we'll have a break.
Yeah, so yeah, I mean, it makes sense. Focus on the things that might make it to SCOTUS, you know, those type of things.
Yeah, there's always going to be something more. So let me see here. My volume seems all jacked up. I think that's me though. Could be me. Anyway, okay. No, it's still really low. Sorry. Just trying to fix it now before I have to fix it in post. Okay. That looks good. That looks better, I think. Anyway, let's see. Okay, so a couple things came out. One on the new civil rights movement had an article, and then, of course, out on the ever-popular SCOTUS blog itself. The new civil rights movement, they had kind of broke down one of them. And basically, it's a huge LBT win, as they say, as the SCOTUS refuses one of the cases that could have sabotaged the Obama transgender policy. Basically, they just refused to hear it, so it goes back down and is remanded back to the original court, and their ruling proceeds. So they're not going further with that, and it's good. Good news for a change. So Monday morning's big news in the U.S. Supreme Court's unique ruling in a contraception case. The religious right has been touting for years, but a huge import as well to the LGBT community and progressives in the case SCOTUS today refused. Let's see. SCOTUS will not hear its docket number 15-861 United Student Aid Funds v. Bible. We were talking about that in our last B show, asking the court to overrule the our defense for administrative agencies. So what did we determine with that one last time? Was that we pretty much figured they were not going to hear it.
Yeah, this was the one that was in regards to pharmacists being able to deny their the ability to hand out certain medications.
Yeah.
Especially since there was the caveat that, again, you had to have if you're going to refuse, there had to be somebody else on staff that could serve the individual.
Right.
Oh, you know what? No, I'm sorry. That wasn't that one. That was Stormans versus Wiseman. That was the religiously motive conduct. The student aid funds versus Bible. When what we looked at was the Our versus Robbins one that they used. That's what they're trying to get overturned. The deference there. That was the one where they looked at the police force and salaried versus non-exempt employees. And basically, that's the one that an agency's interpretations of its own regulation versus what's actually state or federally mandated, determining whether or not they have that ability to, decide, hey, no, this is how we're going to handle it, even though federally or statewide, it's actually supposed to be the other way. So I believe this one is a contraception issue in which the person was looking for contraception was denied by the company, but that's not allowed federally or state. And so it's looking at where do you have that limit, who makes the rule there. And they highlight in the story that, the Our versus Robbins is what they're trying to overturn because it's such an old precedent, but it's still functional and being used today because just last month, it mentions the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals made a ruling in a case where a transgender teen was allowed the right to sue his school district for refusing him equal access to the boys' restrooms. And the ruling was in part based off of Our versus Robbins. So, it's one of those things where they're trying to find something to get that overturned and they're looking for cases. And, the thought was among the conservative judges that United States Aid Funds versus Brianna Bible would be that case that they could, wipe out that previous ruling. Yeah. And, it, not so much.
Yeah, as Clarence Thomas, reading for the right half of the bench, any reader of this court's opinion should think that the doctrine is on its last gasp. Members of this court have repeatedly called for its reconsideration in an appropriate case, Thomas wrote. He noted that Chief Justice John Roberts, Justice Samuel Alito, and the late Justice Antonin Scalia all called in various cases for the doctrine to be reconsidered. So the fact that they didn't is definitely a win for the left. And let's see, we have another one. And actually, there were a lot this week, but these were just a couple that were more interesting.
These were the highlights.
Yeah, these were just a couple of the highlights. Though they may not have been the highlights for everybody, so I definitely recommend going out to SCOTUS blog and seeing all the things that they've done. They also have a Facebook page where they kind of do a wrap up, and I believe even that they're hiring for somebody that will go through and do that write up every week. And I don't know what they're paying, but hey, if you're looking for a job, SCOTUS blog might be a thing to do where you can work at home. Hard to say. So this one was opinion analysis. Justices reject claim that, quote, special outside counsel misled borrowers when they said collection letters on attorney general letterhead. I thought this was interesting just from that whole debt collection kind of aspect, where we know that letterhead does make a difference when sending a letter. So if that letterhead has a big, Dewey, Cheatham, and Howe and attorneys at law kind of, big letterhead, that means something. You know, if it's going to be Morgan and Morgan, or let's see, what's mine? Because I have prepaid legal, and it's DeBobian, Knight, Simmons, Matzeris, and Neal. You know, lots of big names all up there. You know, it kind of means something. You know, that's going to be carry a little weight. So Monday brought us the results of the justices' encounter with the Fair Debt Collection Policies Act, the FDCPA. The court's opinion in Sheriff versus Gilly, displays a court dubious about the readiness of lower courts to see deception in what would pass for routine correspondence in a conventional business environment. The court's blithe rejection of the holding that the letters in this case were actionably misleading sends a strong message that courts of appeals should be a little more cautious about drawing such conclusions so readily. So basically, what I'm getting from that and further reading is that they want the Supreme Court is looking at it as the lower courts are being too reactionary. This is just standard practice. This is not even a case.
Yeah, that's exactly what they're saying. You know, they're looking at it in one of two ways. One, whether or not the special counsel was entirely exempt from the FDCPA, and the other one was whether or not the letterhead was misleading. And you know, I think Justice Ginsburg pretty much summed it up, because you know, she said the letterhead conveys on whose authority that special counsel was writing to the debtor, and highlighted something that you know, a concession that one of the lawyers arguing against it had brought up, saying as special, you know, that if they stated in the letter something in boldface type that said as special counsel to the attorney general who has authorized us to collect a debt, and you know, Ruth Bader Ginsburg basically said it already says that by being on the letterhead. You know, you don't have to make that you know, statement. That's what the letterhead is saying. So, you know, it's one of those ways to
treated it as almost being self-evident. Kind of like the, well, no, duh. And I would love to hear Ruth Bader Ginsburg say that, actually.
No, duh. Yeah.
No, duh. I mean, really? That would be fantastic. I don't think we're ever actually going to hear that. But, yeah, so pay attention when you get those letterheads, kids, because, yeah, it means something. Implicit meaning is intended with a legal stationary letterhead. Though I can certainly see why this case was brought, you know, because it is kind of a strong-arm tactic. You know, how many collections calls and collection agencies are out there? You know, there's thousands of them, especially with having the amount of bad debt that the American public has.
That's actually what I do for a living. I work for a law firm that collects debt. I run the post-judgment recovery department. So once a judgment's been entered, I'm the one who's, you know, trying to find out whether or not people can pay. So
subject matter expert.
Ren would probably be better at it, because I'm still so new to the position. When you transition from maintenance to working in the law firm, it's like whoa, but you know.
Obviously you're up to the task.
But skipping over that, one of the great things about SCOTUS blog, you go all the way down, they give you all the legalese, they give you all the stuff throughout, and then you get to the end. Plain language. What's this about? Ohio hired attorneys to collect past due debts, medical expenses, tuition payments, and the like. Ohio's attorney general required those attorneys to use the attorney general's letterhead for the collection letters. The court decided that it was not misleading for the attorneys who work at private law firms to send letters on the attorney general's letterhead, largely because the attorney general authorized the attorneys to use the official attorney general letterhead. That's it. Done. That's what it's about. Plain language. I like here.
Yeah.
Don't read through all that. This is what we got.
Gotta love SCOTUS blog. It's fantastic. So, and yep, there's our current bench as well. You can see it's Roberts, Kennedy, Thomas, Ginsburg, Breyer, Alito, Sotomayor, and Kagan. What a lovely group of people. Okay. So that was SCOTUS Stuff. And now let's see if I have the right thing. There it is.
It's time for another good idea, bad idea. Good idea.
That was so low, I'm going to do it again.
It's time for another good idea, bad idea. Good idea.
Gas prices are rising again. Wait, that's bad. Well, remember when we were talking about Saudi Arabia? Yeah, well, it's them again. so it seems that they're in... They've got some problems, really. And with fuel prices on the rise, you know, we were talking in the first half of the show about renewable energy and how that's on the rise. Because one of the things that a lot of people don't understand is that when you're using fossil fuels to generate power, there's a capacity load that they have to take into account. So they have to build for the maximum capacity of what the demand can be. And even if for some reason, like lots of solar panels or wind comes into play, they can't just tone it down. If you're burning coal, you're burning coal. You got to spin the turbines. You can't just throttle them back. So there's a peak power load that they have to be concerned with. So that's one of the reasons why prices are just kind of the way they are. But as far as Saudi Arabia, they've got some real problems. This is out in out on Raw Story. And it came out on the 6th. So this is a little older, but if you've noticed, the gas prices are starting to creep up. Mostly that's that's largely because oil is still traded as a commodity, and those that trade on the stock market are affected by a tweet, you know, any little social media, anything, and it'll change. And this is the kind of news that can make things change. So Saudi Arabia is in serious trouble. The Bin Laden Group, the kingdom's largest construction company, has terminated the employment of 50,000 foreign workers. They have been issued exit visas, which they have refused to honor. These workers will not leave without being paid back wages. They're angry with their employer, and some of them have set fire to several of the company's buses. Unrest is in the cards in the kingdom. In April, King Salman fired the water and electricity minister Abdullah Al-Hassin, who has come under criticism for high water rates, new rules over the digging of wells, and cuts in energy subsidies. The restructured ministry was to save the kingdom $30 billion, which is precious money in for an exchequer that is spluttering from low oil prices. Of course, we've talked about why those oil prices were low, as the previous kingdom administration, as it were, the previous king who has died, had his kingdom basically dropping the oil price and continuing to flush the market with cheap oil in order to keep the United States and other nations from fracking, to try and lower the price per barrel. And then
also,
and then Russia came in right behind him and just continued to flood the market with even more. And then we removed sanctions on Iran, and Iran's got billions of barrels ready to flood the market.
And felt the need to stick it to Saudi Arabia just a bit.
Yeah.
Just a bit.
Also, Saudi Arabia, in lowering the prices, was also a dig at Russia at the time.
Right. But it didn't work. Because basically, Russia has more stockpiles and more capacity than Saudi Arabia does. Now, Saudi Arabia is the largest of the OPEC nations, so it basically is OPEC. Kind of like how the United States is the largest power within NATO. We essentially are NATO. You know, when it comes down to it, we're the ones with the most power, therefore we essentially de facto are. Same way with OPEC there. Now, it's interesting because the human angle here is that 86% of Saudis say that they want the water and electricity subsidies to continue. They are not prepared to let these disappear. They see it as their right. Why, they say, should an energy-rich country not provide free energy for its subjects? You know, that makes some sense from their perspective. Obviously, they don't understand the bigger global picture, but what citizens really do, you know. So this just shows that the people that are on the ground there are just as ill-informed as Americans. They don't know the bigger picture. There's a lot going on in the region, and oil prices are just one of those games that people play. When King Salman took over last year, he inherited a kingdom in dire straits. Saudi Arabia's treasury relies upon oil sales for over 90% of its revenue. 90%. The population does not pay tax, so the only way to raise funds is from oil sales. As oil prices fell from $100 a barrel to $30 a barrel, oil revenues for the kingdom collapsed. Saudi Arabia lost $390 billion in anticipated oil profits last year. Anticipated oil profits. I think that's what Enron was doing. So that's not a very good idea. But when it's a commodity like this, you can kind of judge on that. Its budget deficit came to $100 billion, much higher than it has been in memory. For the first time since 1991, Saudi Arabia turned to the world of private finance to raise $10 billion for a five-year loan. That this country, with a vast sovereign wealth fund, needs to borrow money to cover its bills is an indication of its fragile fundamentals.
The indication of its fragile fundamentals is relying on oil sales for 90% of your revenue.
90%.
They've been resting on their laurels, and they haven't been expanding into other areas, which, honestly, they should take some of the profits and start investing in solar and wind. They really should.
I have heard that they are, but the previous monarch was not really into that. And it may have just been age and feeling,
stubbornness.
You know, some superiority complex, you know, because, well, you're a monarch.
I am a nuclear weapons. Dictator. I will do as I please.
Yeah. You're a monarch with nuclear weapons. I don't know. Why not? Yeah, it's hard to say. Saudi Arabia, I believe they have nukes. I believe they are a nuclear power. I don't think they've bothered with, like, nuclear energy because they've got oil. Oil everywhere. But I don't think that's because they can't do it. So that's, you know, the article goes on and on and on about all the details. But really, that's the gist. Essentially, Saudi Arabia is not doing so hot. Except for being in the desert and being really hot. So
expect the prices of oil to rise.
I would expect them to rise based on not capacity, because we've got plenty of oil. The United States has reserves of oil for like 10 plus years. Even if there were no more shipments coming in. Because we actually sell oil overseas. You know, we don't just use it here. We sell it other places as well. But we've got a reserve already out of the ground, ready to use for like 10 years. And that's with government and military usage as well. And they use a lot.
Yeah.
So we don't need it. But that doesn't mean anything because, again, it's a commodity. It is a stock market traded item.
Prices will go up.
Yeah. Energy stocks are going to be affected. Oil stocks, obviously, those are going to be affected globally because, again, OPEC will suffer because of this. And it's all going to be very reactionary. So it's going to be rough. I would recommend, not that I am a fiduciary advisor in any way, shape, or form, but you might want to diversify yourself out of oil. I think that might be a good long-term strategy at this point.
When Tesla goes public, invest.
Aren't they public?
I don't know.
I thought they were public because they had to generate a round of funding for all the cars that they were doing. And it was really tight. You know, with the main shareholder is still Elon. But I don't know. Of course, I say Elon like I had dinner with him, you know, every day. That kind of thing.
Tesla Motors is a public company that trades on the NASDAQ stock exchange under the symbol TSLA.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. So also staying in that area, the UAE, the United Arab Emirates,
yes.
They're building a mountain to change the weather.
Well, aren't they building islands in Bahrain?
I believe they may be doing that as well. But this is something else, because high ground in certain areas affects weather patterns.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you can definitely see that in, say, the Pacific Northwest, where
you see it in Scotland all the time.
Yeah, all these areas. You know, if you've got that high ground, it changes how water evaporates out of the air. You know, it changes air currents. It changes all sorts of things. The desert out there is very flat. It doesn't have a lot of structure that it can, other than man-made structures, that it can, you know, buffet against and change its path. So a lot of weather patterns will just go straight through the region. If you added, say, a mountain, you change the entire landscape. Well, quite literally, but you also change the landscape of the weather. So it says, let's see, currently the UAE is made up largely of flatland, which makes it harder for air to rise and create clouds. Mountains help force air up, which would help create clouds, which the UAE could then seed to increase rainfall. Development of the project is still in the early stages, thanks to the massive financial and logistical details involved in such an undertaking. Researchers are currently trying to pinpoint exactly how high the mountain should be and how its slopes will be designed to provide the best effect on weather. A report on the first phase of the project will be due in summer 2016. The UAE has completed terraforming projects in the past, such as Dubai's artificial palm islands. But this is the largest such project the UAE or any other country has ever attempted. This is terraforming.
This is Death Star level. Let's do something.
Well, they need to. They have to do something because, again, the environment is going to try to kill them.
Well, temperatures rising, they need rainfall.
Right. Temperatures rising, they will then have less rainfall than they already get, which is still paltry. They would have to then import all the water to irrigate fields to create arable land, which is a losing battle. And also it drains the aquifer reserves of other nations at this point. So they can't do that. But they do have a lot of dirt. A lot of dirt. So this does make sense. You know, if you had to sit there in a desert and you're staring at all the sand and you just came back from the Alps because you're rich and you can take those vacations all over the place.
You live in UAE, so
yeah.
you got money.
Yeah, so you're trying to spend as little time in the UAE as possible. And then you go around the world and you see the things that you can do in various places, and you come home and you realize everything's so flat. This makes perfect sense. But what's it going to do to the global weather pattern? How big is this mountain really going to be?
Well, that
it shouldn't affect global.
It could.
Most of your mountain ranges, unless it's a true range and massive, its effects are primarily global.
Localized.
Local.
Yeah. I think this might be equated to maybe a volcano.
Well, volcanoes affect global weather patterns.
Well, no. They affect global weather patterns because they exhaust. I'm talking the shape.
Shape and size is what he's saying.
Okay,
like, shape and size, yeah. A big cone.
Well, if it's conical, it won't affect the weather that much. Actually,
it would affect it on the slopes.
It would affect it on the slopes, but if you're trying to create clouds, it's better to have more of a wedge.
Yeah.
That way you're blocking wind and forcing that wind up.
Yeah, so you have
a cliff face.
Yeah.
And then that generates the clouds. Conical, there's not enough to smack into to force the wind up.
It would have to be really tall.
It would have to be significantly tall, relatively long. You need to build essentially a wall, a naturalized wall.
Oh, they should talk to Donald. They should talk to Donald.
Hey, I know they're talking about, reports on the first phase and looking at these things. And Andy, you brought up Obviously, changes in climate and how being there is going to, you know, eventually try and murder them because, you know, they're not going to be able to maintain the heat. But I'm wondering also on a environmental scale regarding flora and fauna of the area, like increased rainfall, like how will indigenous species react to additional rain? You know, like, are there impacts we need to look at there as well? I'm sure they're looking at them, but, you know, what kind of things will we see there?
When you're looking at desert climes for additional rainfall, yay for just being interested in some climate science, is it may give certain invasive species a leg up. Native species usually are not harmed by additional amounts of rain. The only thing that might be detrimental is it may change the reproductive cycles of some native species because some of them time their reproduction cycle by the regularity of the rainfall. Because you'll have a wet and dry season in certain desert climes.
Well, they are talking about artificially creating the rain by seeding the clouds. So they're taking a two-pronged approach by basically getting the air in the right place to create the clouds, and then by forcing the clouds to then evaporate, to drop.
Well, they could then possibly time it with what their rainy season should be.
I was going to say schedule the rainy season so it doesn't throw off the... you know, the cycles that you're talking about.
You would kind of have to.
Because if you didn't, kind of thing. I was going to say, if you didn't do that and you just kind of went full bore on let's make it rain, you know.
Flooding.
You have the flooding situation, especially because you've never had to deal with that before.
Yeah.
You know, it's something that's
also
new.
Again, invasive species would get a leg up on the native.
And those native species that do time their reproduction, it's one of those things where the prevailing thought is, oh, well, there's more rainy season, they'll just reproduce more. No, it will throw them off into such a disarray that they may not reproduce for multiple seasons, and then you start losing those native species in bigger numbers than you may have wanted to.
Or a species all of a sudden that times itself, it reproduces more, and that's a bad thing.
It's possible.
Because you don't have the native predators or prey for them to feast upon or be feasted upon, which all of a sudden that species becomes a nuisance.
Yeah. Now, speaking of nuisance species, when the big highway projects were being done, you know, across our nation, you know, the international highway system, a lot of sod was brought from different parts of the country to various areas wherever it happened to be needed. That's how an awful lot of fire ants spread across the country.
And they are a variant invasive species which dominate most all other form of ant.
Right. So in this case, what are they going to be doing? They're going to be moving an awful lot of earth.
Earth.
Things live in earth. They're not going to sterilize it before they use it. They're not going to put it into a giant oven and then take it out.
It's already in a giant oven.
But there's things that still live in that oven. You know.
The thing that they should do, it's unlikely to happen, but they should do is they should target a specific region to harvest,
right,
and just use that region. That way, if you do get an invasive species, it's predictable.
I think they just need a reverse strip mine. You know, they need to find a mine or an area that they would wish to create a mine, or, hey, we're going to put a lake over here.
Yeah, that would be actually the better idea.
Yeah.
And with a lake near the mountain, you're more likely to actually generate natural rain.
Right. And apparently they have done that before with Lake Zakir. Zakir? Lake Zakir? In the desert near the border with Oman. Mm-hmm. So they have built lakes before. So moving earth is something that they know a bit about, you know, especially with building islands and things like that, too. So,
well, yeah, I brought up the objection, you know, it's not to say that they aren't. Haven't already considered that. I mean, they terraformed islands for Dubai. I mean, they've taken in the environmental impacts of the things they do, I'm sure. But in this story, the story itself kind of overlooks that there are more things to take into consideration than just, hey, they're going to build a giant mountain and it'll make it rain. You know,
again, the UAE practices Bond level villainy, but for the right purposes.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Yeah, they would be the Bond villains. So they're building a mountain. Yeah, this would be in a Bond movie.
Is it an evil lair? No, it's a mountain to create rain.
They built an island chain to host hotels and do real estate.
Yeah. Yeah, there should be a Bond villain in this somewhere. There really should.
At least one.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, let's see. I mean, there were Bond villains that had their base in a crater. Inside a dead volcano.
Yeah, don't forget Zeppelins. Best Bond villain.
That was terrible. I mean, Zorin,
you don't even have to go Bond villain. In the movie The Incredible, Syndrome's base was in a live volcano.
True.
Well, that's just madness.
He was a bit crazy, yes. This is interesting. Obvious, it's also going to be one of those things that you almost can't miss because it will be something that is visible from space.
Also, it's going to be, in some ways, this is very good for the UAE because if they actually do generate, aside from the obvious benefits, it will become a tourist destination.
Yeah, if they build it high enough and it ends up snowing.
Not even, just the fact that this was made by man.
Yeah, that's true.
That is going to be a draw.
One of the new seven wonders of the world kind of thing.
Yeah.
I think it'd be super awesome to screw with people on the space station. Like, as it's going around, like, you don't tell them anything, and they're like, guys, we need to talk.
This country is building a mess.
Has anybody been looking at the Middle East? Something weird's happening. I think, well, how often does the space station go around Earth? Like, 15 times a day or something?
I mean, it would be something that they would notice it as it was going on.
But they'd know just, before any of us.
just kind of funny in the sitcom-y sense of, like, as they come around, all of a sudden there's a mountain there, and they're like,
You're chugging on that treadmill. You're looking out the window. Hey, wait a minute.
That wasn't there before.
This has been the same every day for 200 straight days.
That's different. Well, things that are now different, or at least slightly different. The Obama administration announced final overtime rule, boosting pay for millions.
Oh, thank heavens for this one.
This is a big one. It's a big one. Of course, it's highly contested by people that don't want to pay their people anything. So more than 4 million Americans could get pay hikes under the new federal regulation that will double the salary level under which workers must be paid overtime. This is coming out on Tuesday. The Labor Department's final rule, which will be finalized Wednesday, so it's already been done, establishes new overtime pay threshold of $47,476 a year for those working more than 40 hours a week. That's below the $50,400 that the administration announced in its proposal last June, but twice the current level of $23,660 a year, which has been unchanged for more than a decade. In addition, the rules will allow for future increases every 3 years. Announcing the decision Tuesday, Vice President Joe Biden called it a consequential
thanks, Uncle Joe.
A consequential move for the middle class workers who have been getting clobbered for decades. He noted that 62% of salaried workers benefited from overtime pay protections 4 decades ago, while just 7% do today. Yeah. But critics, including many retail and fast food businesses, warned the move would backfire by spurring employers to slash workers' hours to take other steps in response.
You know what? That's not necessarily a bad thing, because people want, free time to spend with families and not to feel compelled to have to work overtime.
Yeah, we were talking just last week about the 30-hour work week.
Yeah.
And one of the biggest complaints of people who work in the restaurant industry is the fact that in order to go into management, you're going to essentially have to give up 60 hours of your week just to be in management.
Minimum
at a basic level, 60 hours of your week are just gone. So you're losing that family time. You're losing that ability to do anything else. So that when it breaks down, you're really making the same as the people that are underneath of you. So yes, fine, cut my hours. I'll be perfectly fine working the 40 hours a week, making what I'm making, you know, and it balances out to a fair, you know, result for what I'm doing.
This causes job growth. You know, that thing that's supposed to happen when you give it to the supply side, which hasn't happened.
Yeah, pretty much. Out in the chat room.
Looks like we have a Steven in the chat room.
Around every 90 minutes is the orbit of the ISS. Thank you very much. Also remember, for long-term effects, we already know the mountain behind the Forbidden City in China was artificially created in order to properly feng shui the area. I was unaware of that.
That's cool.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I love having a chat room. It's fantastic. Any comments on the labor deal? We can always use that before we move on. I'm in one of those categories that I am eligible for overtime pay. I've never really taken into account what all that means, you know, how much I have to make in order to get that. I just basically leave that up to the HR department and count my lucky stars when I am able to make some overtime. But that's because more money.
Yeah.
Sometimes I would really like that more time, but then I don't get the more money. So,
but again, it's trying to find that living balance.
No, also, not the mythical work-life balance that is touted in so many HR rooms.
Well,
human capital.
It is mythical in this country. It's a reality elsewhere. And it's a growing reality elsewhere. Hopefully, it'll get to us within our lifetimes, more likely the next generation.
A study commissioned by the National Retail Foundation based on the administration's previous higher threshold said that 32% of affected workers would be converted from salaried positions to hourly ones, and that 5% of workers would see any salary increase offset by a reduction in bonuses and benefits.
Unlikely to happen. Really, really unlikely to happen. Because here's the thing that they don't like telling you. When it comes to the movement of change at a major retail store, it is slow.
Yeah.
And so before they're going to start slashing benefits, they're going to make more localized changes, which is working the employees less, hiring on more help that they can pay less than paying overtime. It's that simple. It's that easy. They're going to take the easier route.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, it's all a money move right now. If you can work somebody at 60 hours a week and not have to pay them overtime for that additional 20 hours, it doesn't make any sense to not just pay someone to work the 20 hours at the rate less than what you would have to pay in overtime. I mean, it's just going to create a job for someone else. It's not going to, you know, really affect the other people. You know, it's very easy to be like, oh, well, we're going to have to knock all this back and then, you know, everyone's going to suffer. No, it's going to create an opportunity. Like, you can't only look at it and go, this is all negative. And be like, well, no, someone's got to fill those hours because the company needs those hours filled. Clearly, otherwise, why was I working 60 hours? If you didn't need me to work 60 hours, I wouldn't have been working them. Yeah, so someone is going to have to do it.
Yeah. This is going to drive up a lot more part-time work, which, as somebody who's been looking, who is now happily employed, but was working for steady work for a year and a half, most of the jobs in the market are seasonal and part-time.
Yeah,
this is going to make for more part-time work. But this is going to make for more likely, more regular-houred part-time work. because you can't use that salary employee who you want to keep just happy enough. Mm-hmm. So they have a regular schedule. So you're going to have a more regular scheduled part-time job.
Apparently, I've set it up where we need to start wrapping up. So let's move along on this story at least, even though there are other things, especially considering that that this week we were to talk about Hillary Clinton's economic plans.
Climate and energy policies,
specifically.
The plans for plans.
The plans to have plans for more plans, or so it would seem. What was your take on this? Because as I was reading through all these, I really came to the conclusion that it's all talk. Well, I didn't really see anything that isn't already in process.
From what I've seen, a lot of it is picking up on stuff that the Obama administration tried to do with a bit more ambition. And a lot of this is just what I've seen in my time in the private sector as a really nice and intensive series of brainstorming sessions put on paper.
Yeah.
Because it's all that stuff that you can put on a board behind you and circle the bubbles. Because it's just that broad and vague. There's no nitty-gritty. There's no life in the details. This is just pie in the sky. This is where we want to be. They haven't done the grunt work yet.
Yeah, okay. This this was written by David Roberts out on Vox. And just to start it out, media coverage of the Democratic primary has not shed much light on Hillary Clinton's proposals for climate change and clean energy policies. But oh, she has proposals, lots of them. I read the white papers, and I called the campaign to talk through some of the specifics and the broader political thinking that informs them. Her plans haven't got much press. Not as much as, say, her gaffe about coal miners, but they are exhaustive. In fact, they are quintessentially Clinton-esque. Rich with wonky detail, conversant with policy levers available, and careful always to stay within the bounds of politically possible, as she sees it. And then he goes to break it down with numbered lists, five lists of three, which is interesting that he was actually able to break it down like that. I'm not sure that anything that says it's quintessentially Clinton-esque really speaks to the American people.
Well, it used to. Back when Bill was actually campaigning for the presidency the first time around, his proposals actually had teeth and math behind them. Mm-hmm. That was one of his biggest claims to fame on the stump is, well, we've done the math. You know, actually run the numbers, and this is what it adds up to.
Steven out in our chat room, since he couldn't join us, he's saying, this is the meeting to plan the meeting about setting times for the actual meeting. Yeah, and of course she has proposals. She has lots of proposals. She has the best proposals. And clearly she's a member of the Illuminati. I think he needs a drink.
This is a backtrack. This is actually them backsliding.
Yeah.
Because a lot of her campaign, both the failed one 4 years ago and this one, has been sitting on the laurels of a reputation. It has not been substantive. Mm-hmm. It fears being substantive because then you can attack her.
Right.
If there's actually something there, you can attack it.
You have to be as ethereal as possible.
Yeah. And it's easy to attack something where there's actual nitty-gritty, because you can run numbers, you can show all the flaws, you can nitpick, and you can sift through. Having vagaries, all you can go is say, the emperor has no clothes, but the American public doesn't seem to bite on that anymore.
Yeah.
Because look at our choices. We have two proposed emperors. They both have no clothes. And then we have one guy who's
pointing at them saying they're naked.
Yeah. He's pointing at them saying they're naked, and he's a tailor.
Yeah.
Anyway,
the five lists. The three key facts, of course it's all threes, the three key facts the campaign took as starting points, so where are they beginning from, the goals of the plan, the overarching goals of the plan, targets by which the successes of the plan will be judged, strategies to get there, and then issues, fracking, environmentalists, whatever those three issues are in the plan. Like, here's our obstacles. It's very project management oriented, kind of the way he's laying this out. So, three key facts that the campaign took as starting points. Starting points, climate change being a serious problem. Okay, we got that. We know that. We were just talking about that. Job one is defending Obama's gains. And then the next president must do more, and Congress won't be much help. I don't know that that's a starting point.
It is the way I can actually defend that one.
Yeah, but it seems weak. It's so weak.
They've been using this argument for a little while now, and it's one of those things where it's really starting to drive me insane with the way they're using this argument. And it's like, okay, well, we're going to get another Democratic president in office, but they're not going to be able to do anything because, it's just Congress. No, those people are up for election as well.
Right.
And the people that are dissatisfied enough to put another Democrat in office are dissatisfied enough to vote the people in control of Congress out. And thus, all of those policies that you say, oh, they're pie in the sky, they're not going to be pie in the sky when these progressive candidates winning these elections for Congress and, it doesn't make any sense. You can't just look at it and be like, well, this is really the only one that's running right now, just president. No, there's a lot of stuff up for election right now.
I will contend this. I don't think it's going to be a giant sweep to the left like the giant sweep to the right was with W.
Mm-hmm.
No, I think what we're going to probably see out of this, just with how the winds are blowing and how we're seeing the radical right rise, we're going to probably get a Democratic president, and it's going to be a closer split in the House. It's going to be more
Stephen points out
contended. We're going to see probably a lot more filibusters coming down the pipe.
Yeah, perhaps. Stephen says that in the chat room. However, we have to make sure that the disaffected actually get to the polls, that their dissatisfaction makes them want to vote. The problem is that the way I see it, the dissatisfaction is making them completely apathetic to the entire process, because we keep seeing voter fraud, shenanigans at all the primaries.
Yeah.
You know, and even if it's not true, it doesn't matter. It's perception is reality. Okay? It is perceived that there is something wrong with the process. And that is causing people to no longer wish to be a part of the process. Because they can't do anything within the system. Unfortunately, everything's the system. So you have to be a part of that system to do anything.
You gotta fight.
You have to fight within the system. You have to be part of the system to work with it, because they're not going to give up power. You're not going to raise your pitchforks and your AK-47s that you've been stockpiling in your basement. You're not going to be able to do that. That is a world that doesn't exist anymore.
No,
the people in power have bigger weapons and a lot more to protect.
And if you're going to fight City Hall, you have to do it the right way.
Yeah. So, go vote. It's going to take time. You'll have to be patient, unfortunately.
And you're going to have to vote a lot.
Yeah.
You're going to have to get educated.
Long-term goals. Long-term plans, people. Long-term thinking.
It's being it is being what it used to mean to be a citizen.
Yeah.
You have to make yourself educated about the policies of all the candidates, their stances. You can't just vote ticket. There are good Republican candidates out there. There are bad Democratic candidates out there. You need to vote for your interests. You need to get educated. You need to know what's hidden in all those bills that are being proposed, those initiatives that are on the ballot. You need to learn.
Those of you that that were watching some of our earlier shows, we went through some of the Democratic primaries, and we went through the GOP primaries to listen to all the people that were allowed up to talk, basically. And there were some people that, you know, were scary, just absolutely terrifying, even more so than Trump, more so than Hillary. Like, let's talk about Jim Webb. That man should be a Republican. He really, really should be a Republican. But he, you know, in talking about who is his biggest enemy, he talked about basically throwing a grenade at somebody. I mean, we got some interesting people that have already managed to get elected. I don't know how they've already managed to get elected. It doesn't make a lot of sense. But it's perseverance. They've been patient. They have played within the system. They have paid their dues. They have gotten along. And they've made sure that other people that they were going against looked worse than they were.
It's also using the spin machine. People only pay attention so much.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And we're all on the spin cycle. All the time. It is really difficult to keep track of all this, because it's constantly, again, as Fred was saying in the previous show, it's all about that 24-hour news cycle.
Yeah.
Gotta fill it. Always something. Something moving. Okay, let's circle back to that other key talking point, because that was the thing that's going to sell the most soap. We got to go back to that, and over and over and over and over and over.
Though, on a side of hope,
we've digressed.
Yeah, we have. TV, though, quick digression. In the hope on the media side is TV is doing badly now.
Yeah.
Cable packages are being sold less and less. People are renewing less. People are cutting cord. Which causes your media outlets, your TV stations, to lean on selling ads. And
it's always selling ads, the
cracks that's causing. It's the same sort of cracks we saw back in 92, I want to say, with print media. Well, we're already starting to see fatigue there. And then come 2000.
Well, the proliferation of the on-demand news that we, you know, anybody that has a cell phone, it doesn't even have to be a smartphone. You can get tweeted, you know, whatever the headline's going to be. It'll come across as a text message if you sign up properly.
Yeah, you get the bylines.
You can get it all day long. So having a print media that comes out once a day or even twice a day, you know, there might have been a nightly paper too, but that was hard to do. But because you got to fill inches. You know, it's inches of column space in newspapers that you got to fill up all the time. That was hard enough. Now it's, I have to fill 30 minutes every 2 hours or less.
Also, you have to do that tease that will get them to tune in.
Right. As Stephen was saying, you want to get your position out in 6 to 15 seconds.
Yeah. No, it's he's absolutely really, right.
Yeah, it's really hard to communicate a nuanced position on anything with a vine.
Well, we're in tweet nation right now.
Yeah. And we've seen a lot of people don't do well with the social media.
140 characters is a very minimalist way to try and get any kind of evolved idea out there.
I don't know that you can get a real evolved idea out there.
It's good for a punchline, but it's no good for any kind of substance.
It's fantastic for Trump. Because all he is just a giant deck of zingers.
Well, he what again,
He thinks in 140 characters. Okay? I think that's it. He thinks in 140 characters.
Part of the strength of his campaign has been what has defined this race. Denying access to the media, antagonizing the media, making them bend over backwards to get access.
Yeah.
Being
more important than the media.
And then the media will all of a sudden just cover you for free. You're not having to go to them. They're coming to you. You have bullied them to come to you. And he's getting tons of free airtime. He hasn't had to really spend
that
much on his campaign to be heard.
And he knew that that's the way it was going to be, too.
He made it that way.
Well, there were early press releases. Well, not press releases, but leaks from within his campaign that was what he was planning the whole time. He isn't an idiot.
No.
You know, as much as I would like to hope that he is not an idiot.
He's not Sarah Palin.
He definitely is not Sarah Palin. But he's playing a long game. And he had a plan. And he's making it happen. There is genius there.
Well, again, also with now Vince Priebus getting the RNC to back him. Because that was one of his primary antagonists up until the tide has turned.
Right.
And now Priebus has to eat crow, essentially, and try and salvage his party.
Mm-hmm. Yes, evil, manipulative genius, but yes, genius. He's Lex Luthor, in a way.
I think this was actually covered in the comics when Lex ran for president.
Might have been. Yeah. Unfortunately, no matter what, Lex was always smarter. So, we'll see. We'll see how all this goes. I don't know. I don't know. We really could end up with a Trump presidency. And you know what? None of the things that he has said tell me how that's going to be.
We don't know until it happens.
We will have no idea until it hits us.
You know, we have.
But neither will the RNC. They don't know what kind of president they're going to get either. So at least we're even.
Well, I mean, they think they know, or at least the people supporting it. But, you know, this is one of the things, and let's just look at it this way. We keep talking about the possibility of a Trump presidency, and you have a lot of people on the left, maybe some people on the right, that want to say there's no chance of that. And as we've gone on, I mean,
there really is a chance of it.
Think about months ago where, you know, people would come, like, there's no way. That is just the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. And look at where we're at now. And what I will highlight is literally nothing else you guys have discussed. What I will currently highlight is we started talking about Hillary's potential policies,
and somehow we are discussing Trump. Yeah, and we end up giving Trump airtime again.
Yeah, somehow we are discussing Trump. And there are things in here that actually warrant discussion that has nothing to do with Trump currently.
Yeah.
You know, like, you skip down, and one of the things that I was looking at and trying to look at numbers for and see things is her stance on fracking, which we've discussed on this show before, you know, at length. And she is still backing her position on fracking. And you know, one of these things, you know, the way that they present it, and it's just where, you know, earlier in the other show, Michael said, educate yourself. You know the science, know what's being told to you, know what's being presented to you as truth or false or twisted logic. By driving out coal, they say natural gas has reduced not only carbon emissions, but also local air pollution, which disproportionately impacts low-income communities and communities of color. The campaign estimates that the shift from coal to natural gas under President Obama has prevented thousands of premature deaths and more than 100,000 asthma attacks in 2015 alone. Now, I just did a very basic search on just that number because it was the first number to jump out at me via the asthma attacks.
Mm-hmm.
One, I know people with asthma. I'm sitting across from one. And two, it's a number. I can search it out. I can try and find it. And I do that regularly while I'm sitting here on the show. I will find what I need to find to add and make things more colorful. Mm-hmm. Everything that I can find, including when I specifically target asthma attacks in 2015, reported asthma attacks in 2015, those studies all highlight numbers that run from the early 2000s to 2010. These numbers don't exist yet. The studies aren't there. They, you know, they're still, they have these studies based off of older
so
years.
So this is
false
just,
science.
Just, well, no, it's just as like Enron, it's mark to market accounting. You're making it a number based on what you
trend.
Think it's going to be.
Right.
Yeah.
What you think it's going to be. And trending. Not to mention the studies that they actually have numbers for, it's only going up. And this goes to 2010. 2 years into Obama's presidency, and it's climbing. It's not go. There's nothing in the old numbers mm-hmm. that you could even speculate a drop. So where that number comes from, I can't find anything to back it up. Now again, it was a very quick search, and I'm not a paid researcher. I just play one on this radio show occasionally.
Well, that's fine. That's perfect. That's exactly what we need.
But I can't back that number up.
Okay, so where it says the campaign estimates that the shift from coal to natural gas under President Obama has prevented thousands of premature deaths and more than 100,000 asthma attacks.
In 2015 alone.
Where's the number?
So those numbers are made up out of whole cloth, really.
As far as I can see, whole cloth. I cannot find anything to back that up. And then, again, there's even the twist of, by driving out coal, they say natural gas has reduced not only carbon emissions, but also local air pollution. That's amazing. As a side note.
So you drilled down. You took that little, the campaign says. You took that link and you dove down.
Yes.
And it still, you just found old notes, basically.
Old notes. I even went and did a search on my own and pulled up information that is, you know, everything leads to studies done in years past, but there are no current released accurate. Because, I mean, think about it. You got to collate all those numbers across
data.
An entire country for years because you can't just do 1 year. The studies are always blocks, usually 10-year blocks.
Yeah.
So they don't exist yet. There's no possible way that you can. You know,
can't even estimate those numbers.
The only way that I could think of is if someone behind the scenes called hospitals and said, "Hey, how many reported asthma attacks have you had?" And then they just kind of extrapolated off that. Is the only
and
thing
you
that I could think of.
Pay a staffer for that. That's not something a staffer does.
But I'm even looking at the way they twist certain things, and like I said about reducing local air pollution. Okay, that's all well and good. Occasionally, I enjoy a macaroni and cheese. I like macaroni and cheese. Where are you going with this, you say? Well, in the instructions for macaroni and cheese, it says, get your pot, put it on the stove, pour in 2 cups of water, boil your water, prepare your macaroni and cheese.
Yes.
Because of fracking, they will be able to change those instructions to turn on your water, set your water on fire, let the boiling water cook your macaroni and cheese. But hey, no air pollution.
Ladies and gentlemen, the sad thing is he's not entirely wrong.
But I'm going to tell you that fracking is good because it reduced some air pollution.
Also,
but methane is air pollution.
Where the toxic chemicals leach into the water supply and thus poison all of you.
Methane is air pollution. That's true. And one of their first priorities is to address methane leaks from both new and existing sources. You know, methane, that colorless, odorless, really hard to detect gas that when it's leaking underground, you really have a hard time. How about inventing something that can find methane leaks before they, you know, cause this problem? It's a lot of, we're going to make it sound pretty. But there really is nothing here except us saying, no, we're going to stick by our guns.
Well, and stick by our contributors. This is
and
one of the few things where I can actually take Canada to task, our polite neighbors to the north. But again,
they'll leave you out in the cold, you know.
Trudeau's administration
nice.
Has been incredibly cozy with fracking and with oil.
Yeah.
And it's the same sort of people who have been contributing to Hillary have been energy sectors, and they want to frack and they want to drill oil.
This will...
It's the same old energies.
Well, no, and this
coal hasn't
will
be... been cozy with her because, well, coal's never been cozy with the Clintons because coal's more northerly. Clintons have their power base either in Wall Street or
south.
In the south.
Yeah. That is definitely where their power base is.
Yeah, and this is always going to be an example of what we talk about routinely over and over again. We mentioned
follow
it in this show, follow the money. It's always going to be money. And so when you get those situations where like, oh, so-and-so is cozy with fracking and oil, the money is the first thing that's looked at. Wait, you're doing this and it's bringing in dollars hand over fist. And it's only until afterwards when entire families die off because they no longer have drinking water or they're drinking poisoned water because it's their only option, you know, that a light starts to get shined. You know, it will be in that very conflated sense when they frack and Florida falls off the United States. You know, like that's the only time that it's really going to be looked at as, oh, holy shit, that really was a bad idea.
To put some history on this, giving an example, back in the 1980s, early 90s, FAA regulations. A lot of our regulations for flight times and whatnot for pilots didn't get issued until people died. You don't get really good regulations until there is a public outcry due to a series of tragedies.
Yeah, because it's easy to ignore otherwise.
Well, or if you're the NRA and, you know, there happens to be a whole bunch of kids dead, like Sandy Hook. Yeah, yeah. Sometimes tragedies don't do a darn thing.
Well, because then you can twist the tragedy and make it work for you as well. Oh, maybe they all wouldn't have died if we were more free with the guns. And, you know, I mean, there's a way to work
it. A good guy with a gun.
Yeah, I mean, there's a way to work it so that even the tragedy doesn't spur the change that needs to be spurred.
Also, the indifference that has been creeping into our society since the 70s is taking root.
Yeah. Now, apparently, one thing that Clinton is in favor of is keeping the nuclear plants open, as opposed to letting them sunset, which is what Bernie apparently would like to do.
And that is one thing in here that I do agree with her, as opposed to him. And
yeah.
And again, I am an ardent Sanders supporter, 100%. I am behind him. That's who I want to be our president. But there are areas where I disagree with him. Again, in our science segment, Michael, as he constantly states, nuclear power, it's fine.
Yeah.
Nuclear power is good. It can be utilized. Let's utilize it.
Well,
we don't need to close them down.
As long as you keep investing in this infrastructure, then
well, remember,
it's risky.
Michael was in the nuclear studies program in the Navy. So, and it's mostly the Navy that actually operates a lot of the plants in the nation.
Yeah, and look,
he turned out
just fine.
Yeah, he's just, you know, no. Anyway, besides that, he knows the science,
right,
is what I'm saying, and he knows that it's safe.
The science is good.
Yeah.
It's just on the private ones that have been making some of the rounds in the news, especially through NPR, they haven't been reinvesting their earnings into infrastructure, and that's where we're seeing problems.
Right, well, that's because they can just take it out as profits, and they don't have to put it back into infrastructure for any additional support. You know, they've been able to just take it straight out and put it into the Cayman Islands, or in Panama. You know, they don't need to reinvest anything.
Which is why when we discuss one situation, you know, on this show, or when one situation is discussed in politics, it's not just one situation.
Never.
We have to change this, to change this, to change this. It is links in a chain that all need to be addressed. And the problem with things as they stand now is we will start talking about this link and someone else will bring this link up. And because they don't connect, the rest of it is all ignored. And it's an easy way to get people to not see that if you just start at A and go to Z, they are linked. It's all there.
And it's really difficult to analyze the full soup-to-nuts approach on any one policy when no one's paying attention after the first 5 minutes.
Yeah.
At most. Or 15 seconds, yeah, depending on the tweet.
Yeah, 6 to 15 seconds.
Yeah. It's really difficult to actually go through all of this because, yeah, it's boring. And not only that.
Infrastructure is boring.
Not only is it boring, it should be boring. Okay? It should be boring. All of this should be boring. The problem is that it's also terrifying if it's not addressed. And that's why we're addressing it. That's why we're talking about it. Because it needs to be addressed. It needs to be talked about. Because otherwise, yeah, it's boring and you're just going to go on to, you know, whatever happened on Game of Thrones. Because that's certainly much more entertaining. But we have to look at all this. It's a pain in the ass. I agree with you. All of you viewers at home. I agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, if you don't think that we wouldn't rather talk to you for an hour and a half about Game of Thrones and whatever else is going on, I probably could make better jokes. I'm pretty good at tearing apart a TV show and making fun of the little things going on, but it's not as important. And that in and of itself is a big step for me, because even a year ago, I was not as invested as I am now. You know, realizing that these things were at the state that they are, you know, it's just one of those things that it doesn't take long to get invested. It doesn't take long to start to educate yourself, and it needs to be done. Someone has to be out there looking this over, and then those someones need to get together and start holding the people in charge their feet to the fire.
Yeah. I mean, we can very easily, after we've been going through this and looked and said all these things, we can very easily go into these conversations with people, and we can drop all these facts and things about this and this and this and this and how this works and this and have you considered this and this, and people's jaws will just drop open, their eyes will get big and say, whoa, no, wait, what are you talking about? I didn't heard any of that. It's because you haven't been listening, because it's boring. It's all infrastructure stuff that's all behind the scenes. Nobody wants to talk about it.
It's in the third paragraph of the story you skipped over.
Yeah, it's page 4, subparagraph 3. Line 5, it clearly says right here that you're all screwed.
And to put another spin on this, and to try and rile any of you who are listening or viewing, hi, you want to be a citizen? You want to be a patriot? Well, if you're looking at our forefathers, they were passionate about this stuff, the boring stuff, the nitty-gritty, because at the end, when all is said and done, this is the stuff that decides your life, your legacy, and that of your children's. You got to get through the boring stuff. Otherwise, you will lose.
You have to eat your vegetables, too. Yeah. This is the vegetables.
It's the only way to get big and strong, America.
Maybe that's what I should call this section of the show. The vegetables.
Eat your vegetables? Yeah.
Yeah. This is the Eat Your Vegetables show. it kind of is. I mean, that's kind of the way it is. Oh, well, what have we learned about Hillary's policies? About what her aspirational policies are?
Purposely obfuscated. She is committed to an aggressive climate action, Hauser insists. It's about finding a way to actually deliver that action.
Vague, yet specific.
She wants to keep us in line to the treaty that we signed to get us on target for our
lowered emissions by 2020, is it?
Lower emissions by 2020, our carbon footprint.
Yeah.
How she wants to get there is not the right way.
It seems to be a lot of, let me get in and I'll make it happen. Well, not telling you how she can do it ahead of time, but
just that she'll do it once we give her the shot.
Right. Yeah.
No discussion about how she's going to try and promote diversification, either privately or publicly, into clean energy.
There's no
numbers there.
Because she's not going to. She knows that her presidency will last at minimum 4 years. possibly 8 if she does something worthwhile in those 4. And her plan is something like fracking or natural gas used as a bridge to get to the renewable energy. So her plan is to just use that and to, I mean, there you go. Look at it like that, okay? When she says something like, this is going to be a bridge, well, yeah, it's going to be a bridge that lasts 4 years so that when I'm done, I don't have to answer these questions about renewable energy anymore. That will be someone else's problem.
Kick the can.
Yeah. So yeah. I'm going to shift that to someone else so that they can deal with it, and I'm going to say that this is a good idea. No, you know what's a good idea? You know what causes no pollution? Wind energy, solar energy. Solar energy never set my water on fire unless I boiled it with a magnifying glass. There, you know, it,
there is that. Yeah.
So
tidal stuff
I think,
is great.
I think you if we went through this again.
In the ocean.
Yeah, I mean, I think if we went through this again and you looked at it with that mindset of look at it if maybe she's only got a 4-year plan. And the reason she's only got a 4-year plan is because she realizes that people aren't going to give her another shot. So she'll get her 4 years. She'll do whatever, you know, little things that she can. But everything is going to be just enough to shift it off to the next guy or girl.
I would like to point out that Mama Van in the chat room is hilarious. I just want to mention that. Because, let's see, where was it? yeah, okay. Important stuff. Bury the important stuff, says Stephen. Bury the important stuff behind the sexy stuff so you don't read what you actually need to know. And then she says, yep, like the old joke. How do you make 5 pounds of fat look good? Put a nipple on it.
Not wrong.
Ooh, you're funny.
To quote Michael, where's the lie?
Where's the lie? Where is the lie indeed? Okay. So what my takeaway from all this is she is relying almost entirely on the current Obama environmental policy. She's not coming up with any new ideas at all. She wishes to keep... If you would like another 4 years of the current Obama administration, Hillary's fine. That's really all I've come up with at this point. All she is part two. Obama part two.
Less charisma.
Yeah, less charisma, but a woman. She is an excellent public speaker. I will say that. And Obama is an excellent public speaker as well. Occasionally, she's funny when she follows the writing properly.
I was going to say, when she keeps her cool, great. But when she gets frustrated...
And she's easily frustrated.
Well, when she's...
She is in an easily frustratable position as well. I mean, that, you know, I credit where credit is due. I don't think I want that job.
But here's the thing. We used to hold our public figures, well, maybe not to near the scrutiny that we do now, but at least there was dialogue and you could question authority and they would have to give you an answer. You couldn't tap dance. 'Cause if you tap danced, you didn't get elected. Now we want the tap dance. I don't know why... Our electorate likes the tap dance now.
We can blame TV for that.
The TV, the media, I mean, even the way that you just said, the scrutiny with which we look at them now, the availability for anyone, I can go off, you can go off, Andy can go off, and we can all start our own news blog, podcast, story, you know, we can all do that. And so we can all ask these questions, and it takes the power out of the hands of the people asking questions and puts it in the hands of the people answering the questions, because they can choose who to answer when the questions are exactly the way they want them to be, as opposed to in the past when we had those, you know, it was a select group of people.
The water cooler moment.
Yeah.
Yeah, where, it, I mean, a select group of people with integrity that we, you know, left up to, you're going to ask the right questions and they're going to answer them. Otherwise, you are going to roast them for ignoring the questions that you had. And so they only had one option. Do I want to look terrible in the media, or do I want to answer the questions no matter how hard they might be?
Your Edward Murrow's, your, hell, Barbara Walters back in the day.
Yeah.
I'll give you this.
We no longer trust the media. I mean, by and large, we just don't trust them.
Well, because it's so watered down.
Right. So now,
I mean, I'll give you this.
Now it's been democratized. Everybody can do it.
Imagine Watergate now.
I was about to get to Nixon.
Nixon would have never resigned.
No, he wouldn't have. No,
he would have never answered the questions.
Yeah, there wouldn't have been a point to. Yeah. Amazingly enough, you know, even with all that and the tricky dick stuff, he had integrity. He had enough integrity to bow out.
Right.
He stepped down.
Also, when he was cornered and had to answer the hard questions, he admitted to what had gone on. I mean, it took a little while, but he admitted to what had gone on. And then he said, you know what? I did wrong. I'm out. You know, like, and there is a level of integrity there. But Nixon now would have been like, oh, no, that never happened.
Yeah.
And piss off, by the way. I'm going back to running the country.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, I got to go back to whatever estate I happen to be living in at the time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's just, it's one of those things
on
where
vacation or whatever.
That's where the change has come. We have watered that down, and it's a
huge
part of the technological advances that have come, you know, throughout that time period.
And at the same time, when Nixon versus John F. Kennedy in the debates, you listen to the audio,
Nixon killed him. But people who watched it on TV, which is why TV was so important to the Kennedy campaign.
Because Nixon was a sweaty man.
Nixon was he was creepy looking.
Terrible. Nixon was a sweaty man who was not well put together. And he was basically doing an audio-only debate.
And I mean, really, if you look at it, if you go back and look, I mean, there are some other presidents in the past and history and things like that had a presidential look. But if you go back and look, Kennedy really starts that, like, presidential look. You know, and obviously there's a reason for that. TV comes out.
The game changed with Kennedy.
Yeah.
And let's face it, Nixon had a face for radio.
Yeah. Pretty much. Yeah.
But.
Or Kennedy, a great face for a mask on Point Break. Great for that.
Well, no, I mean, they made the jokes.
Made it so that there was a angle of celebrity involved in the political process.
Right. That's how Reagan got in.
Yeah.
Celebrity.
I mean, they made the
thought
jokes.
He was a pretty good cowboy. We think he'll do just fine.
The president needs to be a cowboy.
Yep. We think he did a great job as governor of California, and we think he'll do a great job as president. Absolutely. That and, you know, all the religious right stuff that he brought in with him. That's a long story.
The shift in the late 70s.
Yeah.
Was just, we're still paying for it.
Yeah, I'm reading that book that Stephen had recommended, you know, the Supreme Court, religious right in the Supreme Court. It's an interesting and very dense read, let me tell you.
You know,
but boy, there's a lot.
We talked about Nixon having that face for radio, and, you know, it ends up being, you know, just a man slightly out of time.
Yeah.
You know, and that ties into now, because there were a lot of jokes about the Democratic candidates in the beginning that Martin O'Malley is your presidential visual, that when you look at president, that's who you want. And he's up there with, and this is just to say, with a female and then with the wild haired Jew. And it's like, wait a minute. Like, guys, have you seen me? Like, I should be president. This is what I was groomed to be. But I'm losing? And it's one of those things where it's like you end up being the man out of time. Like, O'Malley, if you were running in the 60s, you got this.
Yeah, exactly. And also the same thing with Mitt Romney. He looks like he came out of a politician vending machine.
Yeah.
In 1950? Yeah.
Yeah. He totally fit the part. Absolutely fit the part. Stephen mentions that it was the court and the cross for anybody that's looking for it. I highly recommend the audio version. That way, all the terse, dense stuff, you can kind of gloss over and actually get the gist of. Because, And it is eye-opening. I have been paying attention to it, though. It's like, yeah, that's what I thought. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw that. Yep. Just over and over and over. But boy, a lot of the case examples were those were really astute and terrifying all at the same time. So again, she's labeling herself basically as the next Obama administration. And from everything that I see, that's pretty much the way it's going to be if she is elected.
Yeah.
That is also pretty much exactly what the DNC wants. It is the it is the proven model. They have it, you know, ain't broke, don't fix it, that kind of thing. Stick with it. They do not want change. They want it to maintain just dead ahead.
Well, again, the entire Citizens United thing, it changed the game.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's money and politics. But, well, you know,
and here's the crazy bit. Crazy, insane thing that happened. Remember back when W was running, the first time. Mm-hmm. McCain, his entire campaign back then was based on campaign finance reform. Before Citizens United ever happened.
Yeah.
It was about campaign finance reform. That was his campaign platform. And now Republicans don't want anything to do with it. Democrats, for the most part, don't want anything to do with it. It's no longer the rallying cry and the maverick title that he had back then for anyone to be championing this.
Oh, I don't know if it's ever going to happen. Because, again, it's getting people to vote against their own self-interest. That's the problem with campaign finance reform. When you have a group of officials that can vote for their own raises, it's very difficult to take that power away from them. And though, yes, I'm talking raises as in, yes, they do actually raise their own salaries, the stuff that our taxes pay. But again, that's only part of their compensation. The rest of the compensation is, you know, all the campaign money that comes in.
And the healthcare package, which is...
Certainly, yeah, the healthcare package.
Enviable, yeah, by almost anyone's standards.
Well,
why should, yeah, we have great healthcare when they've got great healthcare?
Well, I think, no, they have to, they're all now on the Affordable Care Act.
Not all.
Well, they can buy extra, but what we pay for, what we pay for, though, for them, is the Affordable Care Act now. Because I remember Boehner was miffed, to say the least, about having to sign up for the Affordable Care Act. And there was video of him doing it.
Ooh.
Yeah, he was not pleased that he had to get rid of his posh thing. And Paul Ryan, he didn't do it, and instead went with the Goldman Sachs account that his wife had at the time. And then she lost her job, and then he had to go sign up again anyway. So, yeah, I mean, it's been an interesting back and forth with that. But, okay, so... For a plan that she had, I really don't see much plan. And then...
Bad idea.
There's Nevada.
I feel like I just aged 5 years.
Yeah. So anybody that's been paying attention, there was this whole caucus in Nevada, and... It got ugly. So ugly. But it wasn't, I'm sorry, it wasn't the caucus. Because they had already voted. You know, in the caucus primary thing. This was actually their local state convention. Right?
Yes.
Wasn't that what it was? I believe.
The Nevada Democratic Convention.
Yeah.
Oh, look, it's Debbie doing something terrible.
Yeah, things went terribly awry. Let's see. They didn't let 64 of Bernie's delegates be eligible. They just completely denied them entirely. By the way, he only lost by like 34. So, that alone looked a little shady. There's copious amounts of video. It's all cell phone video and Periscopes and Facebook Lives and all that stuff, all of that is out there. You can go look. You can see for yourself what actually happened, which is not something the news media is really big about telling you.
No.
Because they weren't allowed on the floor. But other people with the democratized citizen press, they were there. And some actual press journalists were delegates, so they were there with their phones too, and they got an awful lot of following. Things went poorly for them. I don't... There's so much to dig into on this, and it just turns my stomach.
If you... Again, this is something for you. By all means, go to the show notes. Unpack for yourself.
Yeah.
Just 2-drink minimum, folks.
It really is. It really is. It's... this isn't even the best article to go to. This is just, like, a stub.
You can go to the Young Turks. They unpack this for you. It's lengthy, though. I will warn you.
It's also slanted. It is, you know, the Young Turks and especially Schenck are very Bernie Sanders.
Very pro-Bernie. The other place to go, surprisingly, that sort of cover this with a couple of sound bites, very limited airtime. Fox News actually did a decent thing investigating this, going, it wasn't Sanders supporters.
They're looking at the opposition, so of course they're going to give it some airtime. Look at those yahoos over on the other side of the aisle.
Again, it's amazing to see the actual almost begrudging admiration I'm seeing from some of the Fox News pundits for Bernie.
Oh yeah. And they're definitely saying, yeah, he's being shafted. Look at this. Look at this. Yeah. Look at this.
This is so corrupt. This makes us.
And they call us corrupt. Look at these guys. And that's bad for all of us. It really is. The sad thing is they're right. And Debbie Wasserman Schultz, the chairwoman of the DNC, she has been consistently on Hillary's side in every possible
complaint.
Yeah. And she completely, you know, she, as it says here, chides Sanders. You need to get your people under control. It's like, they're people. Stop screwing them over and they won't be a problem.
Also, the people who actually throw the punches are Hillary supporters.
Yeah. There was reports of chairs being thrown, but not a single one was on any of the videos. And there was copious videos throughout the entire event. Nothing happened. But they did, after the state chair, after she closed the meeting by not listening to the voice tally.
Yeah.
Which, you know, somebody put like a decibel meter next to it and Bernie got more. It was completely ignored. The rules were changed at the time, and it was all just forced through. There was no democratic process. There were calls for Robert's Rules of Order, which is, you know, the typical way that large groups of people have to run meetings to maintain order. Those were denied, and the state Democratic Party rigged it. They didn't even want there was a minority committee that was finding out about the delegates and whether or not they were acceptable and things like that. There was a report and they didn't want it read. One of the other people had to give his time that he had to speak over to the person so they could read the report. There was so much shady stuff going on. And it's all on camera. But not making the news, unless it's Fox News. Because, of course, they'd like to see us all, you know, run around like chickens with our heads cut off. And then, of course, she's saying that, Wasserman Schultz again, that Sanders isn't getting his people in line. It's like, well, no, they're mad. And you're making them mad. They have no reason to be in your line. And that's what she's really meaning. When she says get in line, it's get in line behind Hillary. That's all the subtext. You need to stop whatever you're doing and you need to support the candidate that we've chosen, period.
Ignoring the fact that the candidate they've chosen is not the candidate that
the people have chosen.
Well, it's not been decided if it's the candidate the people have chosen. Because while things are tilted in her favor and throw out the, you know, the superdelegate thing, you know, we've had these conversations. She is currently leading in delegates. So, you know, it just hasn't been decided. It's not overwhelming. You don't get to make that decision on your own.
Right.
It needs to be decided by the people. That's why we have this process. And the scariest thing in all of this is that, like you said, there are a multitude of videos. There are videos that are out. There are videos that are clearly pointing to what they have been saying in multiple states regarding these voter fraud issues. And they still continue, much like those things never happened. And it becomes this situation where, again, to take it to that level, we've discussed Trump and his very short-sighted memory on, like, oh, I never said those things. You know, that wasn't me. I didn't say that. And you're seeing the same thing here. So did, you know, obfuscation is a tool of the politician.
Yes.
And, you know, it's like the DNC is like, oh, that's working really good over there. Let's implement it. Or they've been doing it and we've just never paid as much attention because there wasn't a candidate.
I think you've hit it right there. Yeah, we've just never bothered to pay any attention. Or there was never a candidate that needed it. That needed cowing as much as Bernie does. Everyone else just fell in line for the good of the party, etc.
Yeah. They were going to get a wonderful benefits package if they would just shut up and do their job.
Yeah.
Yeah, basically.
But Bernie is not a Democrat. He's an independent. He's only running as a Democrat because he's playing the party system.
Yeah, I mean, it's the only way he would have any fighting chance.
Right.
I mean, he's smart enough to know that as an independent, there would be absolutely no shot for him.
Yeah, and he already knew it was going to be a long shot to begin with.
Right.
I mean, he knew that.
He came in just hoping to shift the conversation.
Yeah.
That was his original goal.
And boy, has he. The thing is, yeah, he has kind of splintered the party, but I hear a lot of that rhetoric. A lot of the, you know, if he doesn't drop out and he doesn't get behind Hillary, then there's going to be this giant schism in the party and then we're giving it to Trump. That's not entirely true because a lot of Bernie supporters are Republicans. And even more are independents.
Yep.
And those two groups of people never had any intention of voting for Hillary.
No, they don't want to vote for Hillary. And those Republicans never. That are Bernie supporters don't want to vote for Trump.
Right.
Actually, Bernie's gotten more independents wanting to vote, wanting to move. Than we've seen since Perot actually ponied up all that money to run back when Clinton was running the first go around.
Yeah,
you know we've kind of highlighted this before, but I'll touch on it again. The anti Hillary line among Democrats and Republicans is so strong that among Democrats who don't want to vote for Hillary, there have been numerous write-ins for Trump among Democrats. And among Republicans that don't want to vote for Trump and will not vote for Hillary, there have been numerous write-ins for Bernie. Now, these are write-ins.
It's such a weird season.
These are write-ins by Republicans for Bernie that literally are wasted votes because they don't go anywhere. As a registered Republican, your vote for a not Republican does nothing. As a registered Democrat, your vote for a not Democrat does nothing.
Especially in the primary process. Yes. It is totally useless.
I'm not talking about the general because that's when it, obviously, then it comes into play because it's general. It's this one versus this one who wins. But in the primaries, those votes are wasted. But they're so anti those two candidates that they're, especially Hillary, that they're like, no, we will literally vote for the Republican as a write-in.
Yeah.
You know, and it's one of those things where, that's great. In the primary, they're not going to vote for Hillary. But when it comes down to it, they're not going to vote for Trump. They're going to vote for their candidate, which would be Sanders. The independents would vote for Sanders. You know, that's why they show those numbers, and Hillary is squeaking out wins over Trump's in the polls, or going even, or losing in the polls to Trump. And then they show those numbers with Bernie, and he's beating him by double-digit points. You know, it's like, how is this all getting ignored? Because some... to quote the movie Step Brothers, curly-headed fuck is running the DNC and making these, you know, like, just making up the rules as she goes.
Yeah. I can't disagree with anything that you've said. The Bernie or bust crowd.
She's trying to actually, here in the state of Florida, because that's where she's from, folks.
Yeah, I know.
She's trying... She's in the pocket of payday loan lenders.
Yeah, her supporters are very checkered. It's quite the motley crew. With the Bernie or bust crowd, because this has been, you know, out in my news feed, I think constantly for the last several months... The Bernie or bust crowd?
I see it a lot.
I don't know. You know, I think I'm going back and forth between whether or not anybody's going to be any good. I don't know. Usually it's with the two-party system, you just have two to choose from. Of course, we're not quite there yet. We will get there. But if it ends up being Hillary, there's the anybody but Hillary camp. Just anybody. What are you doing?
Sorry.
that gets captured very easily. and then there's the anybody but Trump. You know, Trump is the Antichrist, essentially. So anybody on that side. It's so close. It's too close to call. I don't know how it's going to go.
It will be one of those things that when you go back and look at civics as they study the 2016 presidential election.
Oh, man.
And when you look back...
You could write a dissertation. Yeah, you could get your degree on this election.
And when you look at the numbers and you look at the way that it breaks down and the demographics and those things, this is going to be that anomaly that they're like, okay, so you know how everything we told you about the elections going up until 2016 and then we...
how it's going to go. But if the DNC has their way, and I mean, let's be brutally honest, totally brutally honest here. Let's put our hopes and aspirations away. I still want Bernie. He has a slim, very slim margin where he can win.
It would be a contested convention. And
it has to be the contested convention, which is why he has to go all the way through. He's looking to get maybe 68% of California. That's the current polling.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
If he can actually pull off a surprise,
yeah,
it will guarantee a contested convention.
Exactly, yeah. So he's doing well. He's getting there. I feel that it's going to be a contested convention. But even in a contested convention, it's going to be really tight. It's going to be too close for us to call.
If a contested convention is going to be run fairly.
Oh, it won't be. It won't be. Everything that we've seen at this point means that they will lie, cheat, steal, and pull every trick and make some new ones as they go to make whatever they want happen. They have already chosen Hillary as the person. So it'll be Hillary against Trump. Because there's no way that the other guys, because Trump is going to win anyway. On that side of the fence, no matter what happens, he's going to get the right number of delegates, because they've, that with them pulling back and suspending their campaigns, there's no hope for them.
No, they can't even force.
They're not going to get enough. Yeah, they're just not going to get enough. He's going to get the number that he needs to win, period. They've ensured that, whether they like it or not. They should have stayed in.
Yeah.
If they really didn't want, if they wanted a contested convention and anything to do with making him not be there.
Those last two just couldn't handle the heat. They really couldn't.
No, and I'm really glad the Cruz is out. And no, that other guy, no. There's no way.
Kasich and Cruz just couldn't handle the heat.
Yeah.
They really
couldn't. Kasich wasn't popular enough. He simply wasn't popular enough. He couldn't do it.
Also,
Cruz, he was known enough.
Cruz is too scary.
Yeah.
Well,
and too far dominionist and out there to be relevant. You know, he speaks to a very small, super evangelical population that is not mainstream. They really aren't. They want to be. They desperately want to be.
Should not be representing the group as a whole.
Yeah, and that was really going to give them a lot of power, a lot more power than they ever should have. Go ahead, look up Dominionist out there in TV land. Go ahead, look it up. Look it up. We'll wait. Go ahead and pause us. We'll wait. Then come back. Okay. Scary, isn't it?
Yeah, you should be terrified.
you should be rightly terrified at this point. Because they want to bring about the end of the world. That's not the guy I want with the trigger to the nukes. thanks, Steven. Yes, I know all. I already knew about the Dominionists before I read the book. That's one of the things that I already knew. But some of the nuance about the Jerry Falwell universities and Liberty universities and all the law universities that they've managed to actually get accredited. Now that I did not know. So thanks to the chat room there for bringing that to my attention again. That goes back to that book that we were talking about. Okay, with
you were saying.
So with that. What was I saying?
Oh no, you were saying earlier about what is it? The current polls have Bernie at like 68 in California.
For California. Yeah.
If that goes that way, that would end up being essentially a 200 delegate swing his way, because it's a proportional state. So if he wins 68%, he wins 68% of the delegates. It ends up being like 372. So she would get the remaining, and that's just under a 200 delegate swing. Now the difference is right there. So if they go in separated by less than 100, less than 50 delegates, you know, the only thing you can have is that contested.
Yeah. Now this is also why the Hillary camp and the DNC is so adamant about getting him to
drop out
because they see this coming. If he drops out, then there's no contested convention. If he keeps going, then they have to contest it, and then it gets sketchy for them. There's still that possibility. They're scared. Well, they're running
also,
scared.
Remember, during the convention, in order to pay for the convention, they've now gone, hey, TV, pay us, which means there has to be media access.
Yeah.
And the media is going to be covering it. So they can't do this stuff in secret. It's going to be out in the open, and if things are sketchy,
it gets weird from here.
It's gonna be caught. Their only hope is that they have enough media partners that they can spin it the right way and they can just throw in the trash of the news cycle.
It does get quite sketchy, doesn't it? You know, it's a big number of people. I would like to think that the people that are supporting Bernie are rational people. I would like to think that.
Everyone's
some of
rational
them,
until you push them too far.
Some of them are a bit more
far than others.
Yeah, we can say that. They're more apt to riot in the streets, basically.
They have righteous indignation in their hearts, and they're not entirely wrong.
No, they're not entirely wrong at all. They've been proven to be right, and over, they've just been screwed. we've been screwed. You know, those of us on this panel, yes, we're fairly forward-leaning progressive people. If that makes us liberals, then yeah, we're liberals. And if that makes us Democrats, then yeah, we're probably Democrats. Especially in this election where we don't really want Trump. We would like a really good candidate for once, please. Somebody that actually is going to make a difference and not
in
just
a good way.
And not just be the last person. I don't like that. Be your own person. I want that. That's my big issue with Hillary. It's like you're just riding his coattails. That's all you're doing. Who are you? Well, I know who you are, and I'm kind of glad you're not wanting to be that. But at the same time, be somebody else. Obviously, you know, with Bernie's involvement, she has been dragged kicking and screaming in some cases over further and further and further left. Because really, she's, you know, if we're looking through the eye of history at how candidates are. Yeah, she's a very centrist Republican candidate.
No, she is legit a Republican. Folks, this woman campaigned for Goldwater back in the day.
Yeah.
No. She's a Republican. She is a 1970s Republican. That's what she is. She has never changed.
No, she hasn't. Nor, really, she doesn't have to either. In this current political climate, there's no need for her to do that.
But the 70s Republicans, especially Goldwater, if you follow his career, well, there's a lot of stuff I disagree with him on. He was somewhat, especially later in his life and his political career, he was about keeping all the bedroom stuff, the gender issues and whatnot. That's not the place for government. He was about small government, mm-hmm. and the place that he targeted was all that religious nonsense. That doesn't need to be governed.
Yeah, an interesting place for a modern-day Republican to fall, which makes Goldwater more of a right-leaning Democrat in this day and age. And that's essentially where Hillary falls. She is a right-leaning Democrat. But that's only really highlighted because we have a very left-leaning Democrat, an independent Bernie.
No, we have a centrist Democrat. I mean, if we're going with historical figures.
Well, she's centrist only by comparison.
Centrist. He's a little left. If we're going by the old school rules.
Yeah, by history, yeah. If we do that.
But that is kind of what I was highlighting in the history segment on the last show.
There is something
to be said for comparison to historical figures, but we have to kind of stop because it doesn't matter how they compare to the historical figures. We have to look at them how they are in the current political climate, because it is ever changing and evolving. It's rotating. It will change to match what it needs to match.
Yeah.
And so he is
We get confused by labels now.
He is an independent, a very left leaning Democrat, if you want to label him a Democrat, because that's what the political to say that no, not if you compare him to the past. Well, it doesn't matter because he's not running against those people. Yeah. He's running against what's there now. And so, you know, it's
terrifying.
Yeah, it's what's there now. And so in this current climate, he is that left-leaning Democrat, formerly independent, choosing the party system to make his run. And, you know, it's that same, you know, situation where she's got a lot of elasticity, okay? She has been dragged kicking and screaming as far left as he can pull her. But she's just going to bounce right back. If she wins the presidency, she'll bounce right back and she'll go down the way that she wants to do things, regardless of what was promised or what was said, because that's just what I needed to say to get where I needed, where I wanted to be.
Typical politician answer.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's not going to be any real change there. There's not going to be any, like, okay, well, at least he pulled her left. No, he
doesn't. There's the change we can count on, the Obama change. That's the change that we can count on.
No, there are a few things that we can actually probably figure that will happen thanks to Bernie. One of the things that we'll probably see from her administration and she'll be forced to at least reckon with is the raise of the minimum wage. That has to be on her agenda. He has made that too much of a thing.
Yeah.
As well as there is a grassroots push for it and she can't ignore it.
Okay. Can't ignore it.
The New York thing. She did. She did go for it.
I'll see your can't ignore it, and I'll raise you a who's going to make her do it. Because it's not like anyone's going to impeach her if she doesn't go through it. You know, all those people are against the minimum wage hike. So, you know, she's not going to get elected a second time? She doesn't care.
I'm almost certain. Minimum wage hike, hers was just far more conservative.
But
he pushed her to actually address it.
This is kind of where I was getting at before with the elasticity thing, and like I meant to bring it around to the Obama, and it slipped my mind for just a second. Right now, she's running on the platform of Obama's coattails and what's going on with that, and I'm just going to be the new Obama. And maybe this whole process has made me jaded because of who I see on the other side, but that's a really good way to pander to the Democrats that elected Obama twice.
Yeah.
Get the job and then do what the hell she wants. I don't have to give you any of the information behind my policies because I'm going to do it like it already is. And then when I get in there, well, what are you going to do about it? The job is mine. You're not going to elect me in 4 years? I already figured that out anyway because you all hate me. But I got the job, didn't I?
Well, here's the thing. Let's fast forward 4 years. If Trump wins the nomination
mm-hmm.
and ends up beating Hillary, which is a distinct possibility,
yeah,
that is a possible thing.
Yes,
he's going to be a one-term president.
Absolutely.
I don't know.
I'm pretty sure he'll be a one-term because
I honestly don't know.
No, because the Republicans don't like him. They need him right now.
Hard to unseat.
Well, they need him right now. But come around, depending on his popularity rating, they may even choose to run somebody else. But also, depending on what he does, there's no way that a Democrat can't win. Yeah, I mean, because after 4 years of him being in the president seat, you know, there's going to be some stuff that's going to be shown.
Within,
you know, there's going to be a real record of accomplishments and disasters.
Yeah, and within 6 months of him being president, what you will start to see on the Republican side is a lesser known guy that you haven't seen, and you're going to start to see a grooming.
Romney Jr. is going to pop up.
And he's going to be groomed to be not so far right. Let's get you a little more to the center. We want you to appeal to everybody. We want you to look real pretty and shiny. And don't you do a damn thing wrong. Don't you step out of line. We don't need a scandal. We don't need negative news. And they will literally Manchurian candidate the replacement for him so that they don't have to deal with another potential 4 years. I agree with you that incumbents are hard to unseat, but they will manufacture the person that unseats that incumbent.
Well, the other thing that could be manufactured is, as Steven puts it in the chat room, a war. And any president that's in the middle of a war is very difficult to unseat. That's very true. I really hope that he's not going to get into a war, but just the way he is, we might get into a war with Britain.
Well,
they hate him.
It's a president
more
in the...
likely to be hit with sanctions than actually go to war with Britain.
Now, yeah, I could, as Mama Van said, I could see Trump being impeached. Yeah, that might happen. But Clinton was impeached and he stayed in office.
No, I in the doomsday scenario with Trump being president, I don't see him unseated. We have seen in recent history, and I am a student of history, incumbents almost never are defeated. People don't like change. People like keeping what they've got.
Explain Bush Sr.
Bush Sr. was actually, that was a very interesting campaign in what happened there. Because you had Perot, you had this oddball, not beholden to anybody, who first was running hard and was doing well, then got wishy-washy. Because he actually had a head of steam there where he could have possibly been president. But he proved himself wishy-washy, and that lost him a lot of support. But you had this charismatic figure that pulled almost all the votes towards himself, and then the votes got divvied back up between him and Bush. And then you had Clinton. You also had, at that point, something brand spanking new. You had Rock the Vote. Clinton rode in on a lot of newly registered Democrats, newly registered voters, which weren't there before. He got the youth vote.
All right. Well, now take that into account, though. That same prospect, because we have a lot of new voters now because of Bernie.
Well, that could that could unseat Trump as an incumbent.
Yeah.
But I don't see the RNC replacing Trump for a number of reasons. One, we've already seen that Trump can bully the bullies.
It's true.
Yeah. And he's good at it. Because he can... I'm sorry. If you're not in line with him, especially right now if you're up for re-election as a Republican, you're going to get crushed. You are going to get crushed by the Trump machine.
Okay. So it's all right. I can see all that. So, 8 years of Trump.
Yeah.
If he's elected, it's probably going to be 8 years. All right. Now, let's go back over to the Democrats. Let's say that Hillary's elected. Is that a 4 year or is that an 8 year?
That one, in my opinion, is more dependent on the global climate and what gets passed through Congress. If enough positives outweigh the negatives to the common man, again, it's hard to unseat an incumbent.
I figure that probably based on the way Debbie Wasserman Schultz has run the Democratic Party, we're not going to gain any seats. I don't think that the Democrats are going to gain any seats.
I think we're going
to. If they do, it's not going to be enough to be a majority.
It's not going to be enough to be a majority. I think what happens is we pull closer. Again, the way I see the House and Senate right now, because of just how this race has gone, is you're not going to have a supermajority on either side. You are going to have slim majorities in both the House and the Senate. You're going to have a lot more filibusters. There's going to be a whole lot of do-nothing. That's going to continue. Does manage to get passed, though, is the legacy that she builds in 4 years, and the global climate has more to do with her being reelected. If things go real bad, like pear-shaped bad, under her watch, if we get pulled into another war, or you just have the walking disaster machine that is her husband, he can save you and he can burn you at the same time.
He has gotten a little unwieldy.
Yeah, and he's getting more unwieldy in his older age. So, it really depends on the positive, negative, on the big issues and how the global climate is. Steve, if we're attacked, if she responds well, if she go get him, Tiger, she'll be in the... She will be reelected. But if she shows weakness, if things in the war really don't go well, or if just economically we're in the shitter again,
Well, there's obviously so many variables that it's really difficult to take any of that into account. I'm just spitballing. If she's a four-year term,
yeah,
because at that point then the GOP has groomed somebody,
yeah,
at that point that is then more palatable to the overall consensus of America than what she is and represents.
You might actually see, because of how things go, if she's elected, you are going to see somebody who is groomed and tailored more like a Mitt Romney sort of character, but yeah, a little more young, a little hipper. We might even see Paul Ryan run. As he's got pulled a little more left, and I'll give a guy credit, he's learned a lot from the vice presidential run and the mistakes he made.
Between that and now also being the majority leader. So
yeah.
Yeah.
He's learned a lot. He's learned to try and curry consensus. He will say things that are unpopular within his own party for his own benefit. So
that's because he's a weasel.
Also, he's not a bad looking guy. He's got a family. He's
American pie.
Yeah. He's marketable. Now, that would be the smart direction for the RNC to go. However, I have never attributed the RNC for being incredibly smart. What we may see put up by them with Hillary is they haven't learned a thing. We get another clown car worth of options on the Republican side. And whoever gets the base riled up enough to get up there, we have some giant nut job versus Hillary. Man. And she wins, because we're hopefully won't elect a madman. But
there's so much hate. So much hate on that side of the aisle.
There's so much hate in the country, though.
Yeah.
It was
somehow neatly repressed before. Now it's all out in the open.
Again, you have the wonderful anonymity of the internet.
Yeah.
Also, it's easier to find like-minded people. The niche markets, the thing that's busted open our television options, is the same thing that allows the more extreme voices to be heard and heard loudly. Even though they're tiny, they can get their 15 minutes a lot easier.
Yeah.
Also, it means that people across the country, across the world, who are like-minded in their bigotry, can be buddies and organize.
As Steven's putting it out in the chat room, look at it over the last 20 years. The GOP keeps thinking that the reason they don't win is because they obviously aren't conservative enough. They aren't extreme enough. So they have to keep putting more and more extreme people out there. Oh, boy. It's going to get ugly. I keep hoping that this is just kind of the death-rattling cries of the two-party system, and then we end up with something more democratic.
Oh, that would be lovely, but there's...
Because the party system is not democratic at all. Yeah, that is the problem. There's too much money in there.
There's too much money. There's too much investment.
Yeah. We have to have that campaign finance reform before we can have anything. And then once campaign finance reform is in, then there's no need to have the party system as much, because, you know, people like Bernie Sanders have proven that you don't necessarily have to have the campaign system, the party system in place to...
Well, it depends on how finance reform is done.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
If it becomes an entirely high regulated public thing where you just, you get this much to campaign on, have fun. Campaigns will be a lot shorter. The campaign cycle won't be year to year plus. And it'll be quick. You will probably still see the two-party model just because of the infrastructure legacy. That's already yeah. there.
Lots of legacy. Now,
if it's not entirely public, if it's just private money, can still go in, but it's limited to small donations, no more than, say, $5,000 donations. So you can still have the $5,000 luncheon.
Yeah, well, that's definitely going to keep happening.
If you can still, if that's the cap, and you break up super PACs, that's where I see the two-party system going away. Because then it's less and less about the infrastructure, less and less about the phone banks, less and less about that information. Because you can all do that with a couple of good media managers and just enough money to get the ball rolling. It's either there's no campaign finance reform or there's so much campaign finance that a two-party system maintains.
Yeah. I'm depressed now. We should end the show. We should move along. Because I really am just completely displeased with all the possibilities that we have. And this week will show what ends up happening in California and whether or not, you know, the contested convention is going to proceed. And we'll find out. We'll find out more. Of course, New Jersey is also going at the same time that California is. And apparently
that's going to be a debacle.
Well, apparently Bernie hasn't spent any time in New Jersey either, so there was some anger there that I hear murmuring. But yeah, it's all going to be a debacle. I'm sure, and we'll talk all about that on Friday. So let's move right along. Personal picks. I found out on the Verge a fun little thing, and that is Google has made an insanely high resolution camera to preserve great works of art.
Oh, that's awesome.
Crafted by the Google Cultural Institute for every museum. To make the invisible visible in high resolution. Revealing Van Gogh's brushstrokes and the dabs of oil paint. Inch by inch, unveiling every detail of this 1888 portrait of Armand Roulin. And many more of the world's greatest masterpieces. Unlocking the art in the details. The Art Camera by the Google Cultural Institute.
It's just mind-blowing.
Every single museum, every single major library needs five of those.
The capture time has been reduced drastically, says Marza Nicolai, technical program manager at the Cultural Institute. Previously, it could take almost a day to capture an image. To give you an idea, now if you have a 1 meter by 1 meter painting, it would take 30 minutes with this camera.
That's tremendous.
Just crazy, you know, let's see, those close-ups are then sent off to Google servers to be turned into a single gigapixel file. Google has built 20 of the art camera units and is lending them out for digitization. The cameras work like this. You set it up in front of a wall where a painting is hung. Its operator points the camera at each edge of the image. Once the camera knows how big of a space it's working with, it'll set off to work, automatically moving inch by inch, taking extreme close-ups. Those close-ups are then sent off to Google servers and then turned into a single image. So this is the same kind of stuff that they're doing for Hubble, you know, with all the little micro stitched together bits of the sky.
Yeah.
But they're doing it for fine works of art, and some of the images they're taking are just absolutely breathtaking.
Well, no, this is incredible mm-hmm. news. Also, this makes me more and more hopeful for film preservation. Because think about being able to take those high-res shots of individual cells.
Oh, yeah.
Store those so you can pre- preserve those films.
I imagine they'll probably be taken at 4K and then put up on YouTube.
One can hope.
One could hope, absolutely. Because that celluloid is definitely fading fast. So.
Yeah.
So that was my pick. Daniel, you have one listed in the show notes. What is this? Fantasy Flight Games Elder Sign.
Nothing so noble. Mine is cheap and fun. well, not necessarily cheap, but cheaper than the art camera. This is Elder Sign. I'm a bit of a Cthulian horror buff. Also, I love games. And this you can play with a boatload of friends. One of my biggest problems with board games is most of them can only handle 5 players. When I have company over, it's more than 5 people at my table.
Sure.
This can handle 8.
Nice.
Also, with some of the expansions, it can handle 12.
The artwork looks very good on this.
Fantasy Flight has put together a compiled sort of universe for their Cthulhu stuff. So if you've played Arkham Horror or some of their other Lovecraft-inspired games, you will see a lot of the same characters. Also, but unlike Arkham Horror, which is this is what we're doing for the next 2 days, you can put this out, play it, take it all down in an hour. It can be very quick. It can be very easy. Also, it's a game that you can play solo. So you can get a lot of time with this game.
You can play it solo?
Yeah, you can do solo. You can do solo play.
Ooh, okay.
So if you want to try and stop Cthulhu from rising, you can do that. It is a dice-based game. It has all the difficulty of a Call of Cthulhu RPG. There are RPG elements in here. You don't quite level up per se, but there's a lot of equipment management. And it's incredibly easy to play. This is one of those games where, you've got a highly imaginative 8-year-old, and they like the darker stuff. They can play this with you. It is easy to teach, easy to pick up, easy to play. Also, every time, because there's so many different cards involved in the game, every time's different. Also, you will find that there are certain great old ones that you just don't like fighting. Apparently, the luck of the die just is in its favor, while others who might be daunting are a bit more easy than you would think.
At the beginning of each game, and each time the clock strikes midnight, a player must draw a new Mythos card. These cards mirror the increasing influence the Ancient One has in the world. As the investigators continue their desperate exploration, Mythos cards release monsters into the museum and surrounding area, advance the doom track forward completion, strike at the investigators' resources, and add new dimensions to the adventures awaiting the investigators and players alike.
It's a great game. The base version, you are exploring the Arkham Museum. And you are trying to fight the agents of the old ones and try to keep one from rising. It's an incredible amount of fun. It's relatively affordable if you feel like dumping a lot of money on it. There's plenty of expansions that there's one that just expands the base game. There's others that take you to different locations. Like Arkham Streets. There's also an expedition to the Arctic, which is incredibly hard.
Hmm.
There's also an expansion that makes it so that, instead of dying or going insane, you can just go more insane and nice. Then die.
They recommend ages 12 plus, so I think that might be more appropriate. I don't think I'd put my 12-year-old,
we can definitely figure this out. This is just a bit dark. For anyone under the
age. Yeah, well, that's what I was thinking.
They're missing out on an expansion opportunity already, I can see from what you're describing. And part of the reason is because earlier you had said you can play solo. So if you want to stop the rise of Cthulhu, you can. New expansion. I don't want to stop the rise of Cthulhu. I want to go with you and pretend that I do, but the entire time, I'm sabotaging you.
There hasn't been experiences for PvP, but in my experience with these sort of cooperative games, like Legendary, which was one of my picks previous, it takes about 3 years before they add the PvP option in, because with Legendary, it was at the very end of like the second year that it started coming up, and then it was in its third year that they unleashed full PvP. And that's what it seems to be like in the life cycles of a lot of the cooperatives, is that at first it's all, hey guys, we're in this together, till eventually, okay, well, who wants to be competitive and stab each other in the back?
Steven says apparently he's played, and he says it can be more difficult the more people you have. That damn gift shop. What?
The gift shop is, in fact, one of the easiest locations that comes up. However,
there's always a but, isn't there?
It is one that can quickly become overwhelming if you don't deal with it quickly.
I see. Okay, so definitely make sure to exit through the gift shop. Gotcha. So Elder Signs is apparently about $35, depending on where you find it. Currently out on Fantasy Flight Games, it is out of stock.
Though there are a lot of retailers that carry it. Mm-hmm. I know you've got places like thewarstore.com, Cool Stuff Online has it. So, no, you can definitely find it. And it's definitely, if you're a fan of Lovecrafts, or you're a fan of horror, and you want to play a game with friends, this is a great one. It's not going to take you forever. It's not Arkham Horror, which is, hi, we're going to give you all the time consumption of both Risk and Monopoly.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
That's Arkham Horror. Elder Sign, 1-2 hours, you can have a fun game. It's also one of those games which is very easy to take out and put back in the box, which I really appreciate.
Oh, that's good. Yeah. Okay. That's fantastic. Fred, do you have anything?
No, I mean, I don't really have anything. Just the same things I've been talking about for the last 2 weeks. You know, going to push again for the local listeners, free comic book May down at Famous Faces and Funnies. But beyond that, you know, your local area comic book shops may not be doing the same thing, and that's all well and good, but get out there. You know, we had homegrown comic book artist and, you know, author in here tonight. There are other people like that out there. Seek them out. Go into your comic book shop and say, hey, you know, what kind of, you know, independent stuff do you have? Find out, you know, who you can support on that level, and just, you know, start reading, or if you have kids, get them reading. Comics are an amazing way to get kids interested in reading. You know, flashy,
way to promote literacy.
Yeah, flashy pictures, cool design. You know, they become attached to it, and then the next thing you know, you'd be like, hey, you know, they have stories like this in real books too. You know, that we can get from the library, and you know, it's just a good jumping off point.
Comics can be a great gateway drug.
Library, they carry a lot of trade paperback comics, so you don't even have to go out and buy. You can go to your local library and just pick some up.
That's good. That's a great idea.
Yeah, most libraries will have that section.
Nice. Of course. Why wouldn't they?
Also,
why wasn't I thinking that?
For Central Florida listeners, not this weekend, but the following weekend, there is MegaCon. And I know that there are within Artist Alley, there are a lot of local artists, a lot of indies that are supported through the con. So if you want to get your feet wet and you want to have a con experience, go to MegaCon.
Which, if I can promote for them, I know Caitlin Gettler will be at MegaCon in 2 weeks. So I don't know if Todd will be there as well. I don't know their timetable on leaving to go back to South Carolina, but I know at least Caitlin will be there. you know, for those of you Central Florida listeners that may want to get out there and, you know, meet someone who is genuinely nice, we'll probably draw you a nice pretty picture like she drew for the show.
Now, again, if you want to have a nice big con experience, MegaCon's the place to go to. You can meet a lot of artists. There's tons of panels. And it's cheaper than Dragon Con.
Yes, a lot. Dragon Con's terrible lately. Okay. Well, with that, that's it for tonight. You know, we've had a nice long show, an insanely long show. We had lots and lots and lots to talk about. But that doesn't mean that we're done talking. So the conversation will continue on the web until we meet you back here next Friday at about 9:30 p.m. Eastern. So go out to the website at orlyradio.com. That's ORLYRADIO.com. And you'll find all the links right at the top of the page. But, of course, that's not the greatest experience. How about you watch us live and chat with us through the show? And that way you can get the full experience and, you know, really help shape the show into something that you'd like to see more of. And if you like the show and you want to shape it in any way, shape, or form, how about you share it with somebody else? And we could definitely use some of those wonderful likes on all the social medias, and definitely 5-star reviews. Come on, come on, come on. Bring those. Go out to iTunes and give us a review. That will get us in front of more eyeballs. And if you can see in your heart of hearts, and perhaps your wallets, to actually extend to us a little bit of that change in that coin that you have out there. We do have a Patreon page, patreon.com/Cowen, C-O-W-E-N, and that then you can contribute to the show on an ongoing basis. And what my promise is to you is if you do, I will get you both A and B episodes at the same time. I'm still working on that, but that is what my promise is for the Patreon listeners. Otherwise, you'll have to wait until Wednesday for B. And if you just like what we do and you just got a flash-in-the-pan idea, how about you just hit the donate button and leave us a one-time donation right there? It's a cleverly named donate button right there on the webpage, so you can't miss it. Also, hey, how about you leave us an email? Tell us what you liked, what you hated, any ideas for shows, hate mail, unsolicited advice, etc., whatever you got, advertising offers, whatever. ORLYRadioPodcast@gmail.com, or leave us a voicemail or text at 470-222-ORLY, that's 6759. And, well, we hope to see you back here next Friday, right here on ORLYRadio.com, also available out at our Twitch, which is ORLY Radio Show, out on Twitch. We'll see ya. Thanks, everybody. Music for the show was created by Incomptech.com.